Welcome to 2911 Videos. Welcome in. Hi. Here at 2911 Videos, we have a vast selection of high-quality, high-fidelity VHS tapes. Are you looking for some adventure? Real man? Fighting movies? Action and adventure? So whatever it is you're looking for, you can find it at 2911 Video.
Once upon a time, in a faraway land, a young prince lived in a shining castle. Although he had everything his heart desired, the prince was spoiled, selfish, and unkind. But then, one winter's night, an old beggar woman came to the castle and offered him a single rose in return for shelter from the bitter cold. Repulsed by her haggard appearance, the prince sneered at the gift and turned the old woman away. But she warned him not to be deceived by appearances, for beauty is found within. And when he dismissed her again, the old woman's ugliness melted away to reveal a beautiful enchantress. The prince tried to apologize, but it was too late, for she had seen that there was no love in his heart. And as punishment, she transformed him into a hideous beast and placed a powerful spell on the castle and all who lived there. Ashamed of his monstrous form, the beast concealed himself inside his castle with a magic mirror as his only window to the outside world. The rose she had offered was truly an enchanted rose which would bloom until his 21st year. If he could learn to love another and earn her love in return by the time the last petal fell, then the spell would be broken. If not, he would be doomed to remain a beast for all time. As the years passed, he fell into despair and lost all hope. For who could ever learn to love a beast?
Who could ever learn to love a beast, right? Beauty and the Beast swept me off of my feet as a 10-year-old in 1992. Now, Disney came out with it in 1991, but I didn't get to go to a lot of theaters as a kid. I only remember seeing Back to the Future in the theater, yeah, and just Star Wars, Phantom Menace. Okay? But I longed to see Beauty and the Beast because, see, well, we didn't get to go to the theaters. We got to go to Blockbuster and Video Express, and I remember watching the posters come out for Beauty and the Beast. And on a Friday night, you could normally find the Feller family making our way down to Riverside Boulevard in Rockford, Illinois, finding our way to Video Express. Now, across the street was Blockbuster, but Video Express was the cheaper one, right? How many of you guys? Yeah, okay, like, you know how that goes. But Beauty and the Beast was coming out, and I knew that was, like, the upcoming releases, and I knew the date. And so October 30th, 1992, I asked my mom to drive me early to the video store so we could get that copy of the VHS tape of Beauty and the Beast. And it took me, it overwhelmed me, it captured my heart. I loved every minute of it, and I started to draw that rose, right, with the petals that continue to fall throughout the movie. I drew that so many times that I dreamed that I would make the sequel to Beauty and the Beast. But Disney had something I didn't. It was a computer animated program that could, like, do things, and I just had, like, DOS and Windows, like, 3 at the time, so it was me and a piece of paper in Microsoft Paint, and it didn't go so far. But Disney, this was one of the first times they used computer graphics to not just set the background, but to help tell the story in one of their movies. And Disney swept me off my feet with this story of Beauty and the Beast. And I remember just all of this stuff and just diving into the movie. And of course, it's a musical too, right? With Angela Lansbury's Tale as Old as Time, yeah? Now, I realize that not every 11-year-old boy loves musicals, okay? But by the time I was 11 or 12, I had traded in my clarinet to play the oboe, yeah? Okay, okay. And then I also had started to learn piano, only we didn't have a piano. It was like a Technics with like from the 1970s. I was born in 81. This thing was older than me. And with one volume, which I'm sure my parents loved, it helped me convince them to get me a real piano one day. But during those years, I learned a few songs. And one of them was Meat Loaf's I Would Do Anything for Love. I would do anything for... Yeah, okay. Look it up. It's great. And then, of course, that same summer, I learned Beethoven's For Elise. And yeah, oh, every piano player's dream. Anyways... And of course, my proudest moment came that summer when I learned Tale as Old as Time. And I tried to sing it a little bit like Angela Lansbury because she had my heart, and that's weird. Anyways, but, you know, Tale as Old as Time. Song as Old as Rhyme. Yeah, okay. Okay, thank you. Thank you. I worked hard at that in earlier years. But, and then, of course... Be our guest. Okay. Okay. All right. Oh, yeah. I think I made up a dance to that in junior high, and it was great. My friends thought I was weird, and still weird through those awkward years, but still weird, and it's okay. But I loved that movie, and there's something about a movie where it tells the story of transformation that just captures your heart. And when storytelling gives me hope that even the most ugly and terrifying beast can transform to something, someone better, it instills a hope that there can be transformation and change, not just in that story, but in my story, in our world, in us. We find ourselves sitting at the feet of storytellers like this. And we realize that we're broken people too, that we are broken and we live in this broken, hurting world. And while some of us find ourselves facing issues in our relationships that have been escalated and accelerated during this season of quarantine, beyond what we can imagine, still others sit lonely in our rooms, heartbroken. And on top of that, it's not just in our lives, it's in our world. Seeing the racial tensions rise to hopefully finally seek justice for what needs to be sought in our world. We live in this broken world. And sometimes those tensions need to rise, like in seeking justice. But sometimes those tensions don't need to rise. I was walking into our offices for the place that I work at, and it's in a business park. And I was walking in the other day with my mask, and we're supposed to walk in with all of that, and we do our, like, sanitizing and everything. But on the way in, this guy, this bigger guy that was a little older than me, and he's not wearing a mask, and I was wearing a mask, and he looks at me, and he starts to make comments. And I thought he was joking, so I kind of laughed and was like, yeah, I am walking the other way because I'm going into the office. And then I realized, like, I got inside and I realized that there was this grown bigger man and me, a grown man, but kind of smaller. Like, he was trying to pick an argument with me over masks. And tensions are just high in our world. In fact, as I told that story, some of you are thinking, man, I can't believe that guy wasn't wearing a mask. And still others of you might be thinking, man, I can't believe you were wearing a mask in the middle of a parking lot, not around anybody. I get it. I get it. But we're in this weird, crazy, high-tension world right now. And some of you feel your own tension because throughout this, you feel broken and you feel like a wreck. And God has always been spotting the brokenness in our world and calling out the beauty. He is always spotting the brokenness and calling out the beauty. Even knowing that we won't really see the fullness of that this side of heaven. but we get to see parts of it. And so this weekend, I wanted to just point out, I think, four kind of characters from Beauty and the Beast. Angela Lansbury, right? Not her. But point out four characters from Beauty and the Beast that I think that we might see in our communities, that we might see even in our families and in our own lives, and that we might even be able to identify with. And so first of all, of course, it's the obvious one, the Beast. Did you know that there's a guy in the Bible like this? Like, it's kind of the original Beauty and the Beast. Now, there's no bell, but it's kind of a crazy story. If you get some time, like, just write this down. We're not going to dive into this, but Daniel 4 tells the story of this guy named Nebuchadnezzar. And he grows, like, hair that looks like eagle's wings. I'm not sure about that description, but it's in the Bible. And then he grows, like, claws that are like eagle's talons or things. Is that the right word, talons? Anyways. It's a crazy story. Read it. But here's the thing is he falls into this like kind of curse from God in that moment because of his arrogance, because of his pride. And man, it shows up throughout God's word is that God invites us away from arrogance and pride. And maybe you see the beast in your community. It's the easiest one to call out. It's the easiest one to see because it's the people that in other people, of course, right? The obvious ugly beast. They're frustrated, they're angry all the time, they're always complaining, they're whining, they're hurting other people around us. But what about us? What about you and me? We each have broken parts in our lives too. The beast had become who he was because he wasn't concerned about anyone but himself. And sometimes we find ourselves there, and sometimes we find ourselves in that broken place. And so there's our first character. And we find ourselves ugly like that beast. And so if you're sitting in a room with somebody, look at them and say, you're ugly. Just kidding. Don't say that. Don't, like, listen to that. That's a bad idea. Which, by the way, if you're sitting in your room on your own, that's okay. Nobody told you you're ugly. We're good too, right? Okay? Like, anyways, terrible joke. But like, we all have these moments where we're kind of like the beast. And we have people in our community that are kind of like the beast in this story. It's so easy to get caught in our emotions and our messes and be a beast. And then, of course, there's Belle. We love Belle. She's our hero. She's the hero of the story. And while at first she was devastated to lose the life she knew, her dad and the books that she would read and things like that, spoiler alert, she does fall in love or starts to fall in love with the beast. But while she starts out losing all of that, we see some beauty come out of her in such an amazing way. She's our hero in the story. And well, we're not talking about the most healthy, like, dating relationship here. Like, just like, if that's your dating relationship, it's time to say. Anyways, but just saying, so a little advice there. But Belle, she starts to see the goodness in the beast. Belle's a character that we probably see in our own communities. Might be in a nurse that's taking care of a loved one at the hospital right now. It might be in a coworker that took some extra time to make sure you're doing okay. But we see Belle's, and sometimes we even get to be the Belle. And I think it was Belle's genuine care for almost everyone that she came in contact with that helped people bring hope, helped her bring hope into the beast's life. Somehow, even though Belle was locked away in this castle, she decided not to just be frustrated about her situation, but instead to see her situation with eyes of hope. We need bells in our communities and in our lives to see the hopeless with eyes of hope. And then there's kind of another set of characters I wanted to look at, and it's the villagers. And what about the villagers? These are the people in the town that were back from where Belle lived, where she had grown up, where her dad was, and they wanted their lives one way, comfortable. And they want it their way, and they want it to be about themselves, and their hero is about the person with the biggest muscles and the bronze and Gaston, and that's what they were all about. But they were passionate about keeping things the way they wanted them, just about themselves. They didn't seek to understand. They even called Belle at some point. They called her weird because she liked to read books. They called her beautiful but weird. And sometimes we find ourselves with the villagers, You know, the villagers, rather than being led by love, ended up being led by fear and hate. And they let fear and hate drive them towards the beast's castle to destroy him. There was no hope in their eyes. And sometimes we find ourselves there. I think about what Paul wrote to Timothy in 2 Timothy 3:2, when he said, "For people will love only themselves and their money. They will be boastful and proud, scoffing at God." I found myself with the villagers sometimes. I find myself there. And I wish we could all be like Bell, right? To have hope in our eyes that even the beasts in our lives would go from broken to beautiful. When no one else can see it, what if we had that perspective like Bell did? How many more fairy tales, how many stories of transformation could happen if we would have that type of perspective and that type of character in our lives? But in life, a lot of the time, we move between all three of these characters. Rarely will you find somebody that's just one of these. But we kind of move from one to the other. Sometimes, like Bell, we wake up with perspective, fresh and ready to go. But by our first Zoom call at 9 o'clock, we find ourselves with the villagers defending our own things and seeking out our own goodness and just being about me. And sometimes even worse, it escalates to being the beast in the middle of the day, only concerned about ourselves, defensive and angry and not loving anymore. Life pushes us around. Our circumstances usually dictate our perspective, but God is our refuge. So rather than letting our circumstances, even when they get good, be our refuge, let's let God be our refuge and our strength. Psalm 46, 1 through 2 says that God is our refuge and strength. He always ready to help in times of trouble. We need this. We need God to be our refuge and strength, so we will not fear when earthquakes come and the mountains crumble into the sea. Yeah. We don't have to be tossed around. Man, I feel tossed around during this season. From frustrated emotions to other times being super glad for things, and then at the same time, my emotions just all over the place during this season. You go from being Bell to the beast to the village, the villagers, and we find ourselves tossed. But if God will be our refuge and our strength, I sat on the phone with some of you as you watch your marriage crumble in front of your own eyes. And still others of you who have lost jobs and others of you who are struggling to stay sober through this season. And if we'll just allow God to be our refuge and strength. And man, it's hard though, right? We wake up and things are good and we're like Bell, but then by the end of the day, we're like the beast and it's so hard, but go back to God being our refuge and our strength. And the amazing thing is that God, as we invite God to shape and form us, he'll continue to seek out in our lives places of brokenness. Not to point them out and to put his thumb on us, but to point them out and to bring beauty in the brokenness. And at some point, you'll look up and see that there is something there that wasn't there before. And we get to see that in this next clip.
There's something sweet and almost kind, but he was mean and he was coarse and unrefined. And now he's dear and so unsure. I wonder why I didn't see it there before.
And of course, the fourth character that we all have to love. You can't not love Chip. Yeah. Chip. The kind of silent hero in the movie. I love Chip, and before we move on, who could forget him, right? The little teacup among teacups. Mrs. Potts' son, Mrs. Potts, and that was weird. And he lives up to his name. He's got a chip in the edge of his cup, and he's broken. And he's fallen apart, and yet here, and the beautiful thing of this story is that, like a lot of us, he's broken. And even on our best days, we're broken too. But here's the thing, is again and again throughout the movie, if you watch closely, Chip gets used. Chip has a purpose throughout this movie. And I think that it's so important that we don't miss moments like this. More than a Disney movie is that even when we're broken, even when we're falling apart, you still have a purpose and God still has a plan for your life. And he still cares about you and he still wants to use you in some amazing ways, but most of all, to bring beauty to even your brokenness. Just because you feel broken or incomplete, there's a purpose and a plan for you too. There's a purpose there. But we have to let God in. And we have to let God pick up the pieces. I love that there's a prophet in the Old Testament that was crying out to God, a prophet that God had spoken to. Like, God had used him in some great ways, but still he's calling out to God. And this is what he says, God, pick up the pieces. Put me back together again. You are my praise. It's Jeremiah. He's calling out to God, pick up the pieces. Put me back together because you, God, you're my refuge, you're my strength, you're the one I praise and the one I seek. See, God forms beauty amidst our brokenness. But it's not just in Disney movies, and it's not just a good idea that I can stand up and talk about, but it's God's idea. And one of my favorite things about the Bible is time and time again we see these stories of transformation, where God steps in. In Luke 7, there's this story of this Pharisee, and he invites Jesus over to hang out with him with a few friends, and they hang out, they're eating dinner, and in those days, it wasn't weird for you to have your door wide open, and whoever wants to walk by and come on in, like, awkwardly could come in. Like, that's awkward for us, but this was normal back then. And so in Luke chapter 37, Jesus is hanging out with these Pharisees and hanging out with these guys. And it says in verse 37, when a certain immoral woman from that city heard he was eating there, she brought a beautiful alabaster jar filled with expensive perfume. And she knelt behind him at his feet, weeping. Her tears fell on his feet. She wiped them off with her hair, and then she kept kissing his feet and putting perfume on them. Now, I am not a foot person, okay? Like, sometimes I touch my own feet and I go wash my hands. It's like worse than, anyways, but this wasn't a normal thing for somebody to come in with that much perfume, and it was rare. It wasn't like TJ Maxx perfume or cologne, where I buy a cologne. Like, that's not what she was walking in with. She was walking in with the good stuff, and she comes in and washes Jesus' feet. Normally, you get a wet wipe or just something to clean off your feet back then, but she's wiping them off with her hair. It's an act of worship. As if to say, Christ, you've changed my brokenness, my dirtiness, my absolute wrecked life and made me whole. Can I at least wash your feet? She washes Jesus' feet, and when the Pharisee who had invited Jesus into this, he saw this and he said to himself, if this man were a prophet, he would know what kind of woman is touching him. She's a sinner. And Jesus answered his thoughts, and Simon, he said to the Pharisee, I have something to say to you. Go ahead, teacher, Simon replied. I don't think he was expecting what was about to come. Then Jesus told him this story. A man loaned money out to two people, 500 pieces of silver to one and 50 pieces to another. But neither of them could repay him, so he kindly forgave them both, canceling their debts. Who do you suppose loved him more after that? Simon answered, I suppose the one for whom he canceled the larger debt. That's right, Jesus said. Then he turned to the woman and said to Simon, look at this woman kneeling here. When I entered your home, you didn't even offer me water to wash the dust from my feet, but she has washed them with her tears and wiped them with her hair. You didn't greet me with a kiss, but from the time she first came in, she has not stopped kissing my feet. You neglected the courtesy of olive oil to anoint my head, but she has anointed my feet with rare perfume. I tell you, her sins, and they are many, have been forgiven. So she has shown me much love, but a person who's forgiven little shows only a little bit of love. Then Jesus said to the woman, your sins are forgiven. The men at the table said among themselves, who is this man that he goes around forgiving sins? And Jesus said to the woman, your faith has saved you. Go in peace. Peace. I can imagine just that sense of peace that came over her that she probably hadn't had for a long time. As her past sins and her brokenness had haunted her for so long. And it's foreign to us sometimes too in our lives today. But he says, peace. Go in peace. He gives us peace because we're forgiven. Our brokenness is made whole by him. Jesus saw the woman at his feet washing them, and he knew her brokenness. He knew her sin. But he didn't let that stop him from bringing hope to her. And I think it's interesting that in that same room was Simon, this Pharisee. And in Luke, it calls him a Pharisee. And in Matthew and the book of Mark, we read about Simon a little bit more, and we get to know that he used to have leprosy. It was a disease that kept him from being around people, that pushed him out of community. And somehow, he doesn't have it anymore in this moment. I would guess that Jesus probably had healed him. But how quickly we forget where we've come from as he sat there judging this woman with the alabaster jar. How quickly we forget that. And Jesus gently reminds Simon, grace is for all. He reminds Simon that God constantly is walking into our brokenness. He seeks out our brokenness and he brings beauty into those places of our lives. But it's so easy for us to become the villagers or the beast in the story, or even Chip feeling like there is no hope for us. But Jesus is inviting us to follow him too. He's inviting us to follow him like Belle, more importantly, to follow Jesus. To have hope for God, to bring beauty to the brokenness of our world, our community, and our own lives. To hear him say, your faith has saved you. Go in peace. Now, this next scene is one that I had to show you. It's my favorite. It's the one that I dreamed of recreating in the sequel that Disney wouldn't let me. It is my favorite scene from here, and I wanted to show you. Tale as old as time.
Ever just the same. Ever a surprise. Ever as before. Ever just as sure as the sun will rise. Tale as old as time. Tune as old as song. Bittersweet and strange. Finding you can change. Learning you were wrong. Certain as the sun. Rising in the east. Tale as old as time. Song as old as rhyme. Beauty and the Beast. Shh. Tale as old as time. song as old as rhyme. Beauty and the Beast. Off to the cupboard with you now, Chip. It's past your bedtime. Good night, love.
Could you imagine if Belle had given up on the Beast? I would have missed my favorite song. But the greatest thing is the transformation would have never happened, and it did because Belle didn't give up. And God doesn't give up on us. He never gives up on us because God is inviting you to let him bring beauty to your brokenness. You have to let him in. I love that Romans 8:31 says that if God is for us, who can be against us? How can we lose is the way the Message version puts it. So what does it look like when God shapes our lives? It doesn't mean that you're always perfect and you don't mess up. It looks a lot like inviting God into your story, like Jacob Osef and his mom, Alicia, did. See, Jacob and Alicia in 2010 found themselves in a rough spot. Alicia was struggling with an addiction to meth and pushing her three kids away, and her kids would spend time away from home as much as they could, while Alicia found herself a lot of the time just in her bedroom, hiding. Struggling. Jacob ended up living at his dad's house, which wasn't much better because he was an alcoholic. A lot of the time, Jacob would come home from school and find his dad sitting there on the couch, surrounded by empty liquor bottles, passed out. And as the years passed, tensions rose for Jacob at his dad's place, and one day he was over at his mom's and he called his dad and said, "Dad, I'm not coming back." But he looked at his mom and he just point blank said, "Mom, you need to change. I want you to change." His mom, without saying a word, turned around and walked away from him. Walked into her room and shut the door. She was in there for hours. Jacob says that he prayed for the first time that night. And he said, "God, would you protect me? Would you set my mom free? Would you help her to change? Because this where we're at is a mess and we are broken and I don't know how to fix it." A few hours later, Alicia walked out of her room and she said just simply, "Okay." And that's the night they began her road to health. That's the night that she began her road to discovering Jesus and letting Jesus transform her life. Jesus, who had never given up on her or Jacob. A couple months later, they found themselves at a church and sitting in the service that weekend, they heard the pastor say, "Hey, it's baptism weekend, and if you want to follow Jesus, maybe it's time for you to take this next step and get baptized." And Jacob, he got up and he got baptized that day. And a month later, his mom got up and got baptized too. See, that's the transforming life of and way of God, that when you surrender to him and let him in, he can transform your life. And God transformed his life. It's amazing to hear that Jacob is pursuing a calling to be a kids pastor, to see God continue to transform kids' lives just like his life was transformed when he was a kid. And Alicia, she usually is sitting right up here in the front row on the weekend when we meet in person. See, that's what God does. It doesn't mean you're going to be perfect. Jacob and his mom aren't perfect, but God is doing an amazing transformative work in their lives. And that's the God that we serve, the God that we follow. He brings beauty to our brokenness. And Jesus encountered the broken people all the time. And he brought beauty to the broken. The woman with the alabaster jar. And even Simon, who sat in that room, who used to be a leper and now was judgmental, he brought transformation. He brought beauty into his life. In Mark 9, there was a boy possessed with a demon, and his dad brought him to be healed, and he walked away set free. There was a woman who was caught in adultery and thrown at Jesus' feet. She left forgiven. That is the God we serve. Mary Magdalene, who had been demon-possessed, became a follower of Jesus, and Paul, who held the coats of people who were stoning and executing Christians, was transformed so that lives would be changed, and he brought the gospel of Christianity to much of the world. See, story after story of transformation happens in the Bible. He is the God that never gave up on these people, and he never gives up on you, because he is always seeking to bring the beauty to the broken. To bring beauty to the broken. This weekend, a few of us as pastors get to stand on the banks of the Salt River and watch Brady, one of our recently graduated seniors, get baptized. And here's the thing, is along that bank will also be standing a youth leader that used to pour into his life when he was only a sophomore in high school, but it takes years sometimes to see transformation in our lives. Sometimes it's overnight. But God is the God who transforms us and makes us new. So what part of your life is broken that maybe you've given up hope on, that you need to let God in on? I think every one of us has been forced during the season to come face to face with more of our brokenness. Whether it's been the pressure on a failing marriage or relationship, or our families falling apart at the seams, or clinging to false securities, or our fear, or anger, or struggling with staying sober, or struggling to wait for that right person from God to spend the rest of your life with, whatever it is, God is here to bring beauty to the broken parts of your life, and to step in. And maybe you're watching this weekend, and you want to join up with us as we follow Jesus, as we allow him to come stand on our side and transform us. Because if God is for us, who can be against us? How can we lose? Maybe you're hearing this and you're saying, I want to follow Jesus. I want to know what it is to follow him, to let him into the broken parts of my life. Well, it starts this simple. It starts by simply saying, Jesus, I commit my life to you. I know I can't fix it on my own, the broken pieces, but God, you can, and I believe that you can, and so I invite you in. And if that's you, I'm gonna pray with you first, and then pray with all of us. But if that's you, I wanna encourage you too, to click on the I commit my life to Christ button. Got some people online that want to pray with you too, but I want to pray with you right here in this moment. Dear Jesus, we thank you that you keep seeking out the broken parts of our lives. And you bring beauty to them. And I don't want to just sit here and wait and hear about other people's lives being transformed, but I commit my life to following you, Jesus, and discovering what it is to let you bring beauty to my brokenness. In Jesus' name. If that's you that just prayed that, I want to encourage you, tell somebody, whether it's on the stream or wherever it is, but whether that's you that just prayed that, or for all of us in this room, as we close out with this last song this weekend, I want to just encourage you to pause as we sing this song, whatever you're doing, man, if you're distracted in your kitchen or wherever you're at, just a pause, and instead during this song, allow God into the broken parts of your life and allow him to declare over you peace. Peace. Just like Jesus did with that woman at his feet. Because he looks deep into the broken parts of our lives. And he finds beauty there. Let me pray as we sing, as we go into this last song. God, for all of us, we realize that we so often seek our own things, but Jesus, you are constantly seeking out the broken parts of our lives. And we want to run to you because you're the only one that can bring beauty to the brokenness. In Jesus' name.